Hi, good evening. My name is Dr. Tony Arnold McFarland, and we're getting ready to get started with our meeting for the evening. Welcome. And just a few housekeeping items. We are recording. We will provide time for questions throughout the meeting. So if you don't mind, please hold those. Please keep yourself on mute. And also be conscious of any background noise. We do have a tight schedule tonight, so I do want to make sure we're conscious of everyone's time, and we're going to get started. All right. So our theme tonight is keeping an eye on equity. Actually, that is our theme in RTP NSBE for the next several months. A very timely topic. This is a topic that we started taking notice of based on the events of 2020. And we were planning to continue to do this. And it seems that we were a little ahead of the events that have unfolded yet even in 2021. So without any further ado, we're gonna get right into our meeting. And we always open the NSBE meetings with the mission. Even people who are our guests, we invite them to read the mission along with us. If we were meeting in person, we would stand and say that, but I will just read it for us tonight and you can just read along. NSBE's mission is to increase the number of culturally responsible Black engineers who excel academically, succeed professionally, and positively impact the community. And if you are new to NSBE, if you're not familiar with the organization, we will talk a little bit about the history, but I'm going to ask you throughout the night to put a few things in the chat. So let us know who you are, who's here, why did you decide to come out? Are you a student? Are you a professional? Are you in another organization? Are you a concerned citizen? And you heard about this, saw us on Eventbrite or Facebook or some other social media platform. Tell us who you are and why you came out tonight. So if you don't mind, go ahead and put that in the chat. And I'll get one of my members or tech support personnel to let us know who has chimed in tonight. This is the agenda. Like I said, we have a lot to cover, some great and exciting topics. And just to give you a little background on NSBE, we say that it's NSBE, and you actually see NSBE, but that stands for the National Society of Black Engineers. We were founded in 1975 at Purdue University. And actually, the founders over here, let me move this so you guys can see. And if you at any point are not able to hear or see, just let me know. But basically, the Chicago Six, as they are known, they were pretty much concerned about equity in education. And that's because they attended Purdue, a predominantly white institution, and recognized that 80% of the freshmen, the Black freshmen, were dropping out. They saw this as a problem because they knew these were very capable students, and they went to the Dean of Engineering at their school. Eventually, they sent out a communication to the Dean of Engineering programs at about 40 other schools, organized a conference. Over time, they recognized there were some things that needed to happen to make sure we were able to retain Black students in the engineering program. As a result, NSBE was birthed, and they were able to start this as a national organization. And we're here today. They started out with just a college group, and it's still a college-led organization, but eventually that evolved into having a professional chapters and NSBE junior chapters. And just a little bit more about NSBE, we have several programs and other zones, I would say zones and programs rather, and I just want to make sure I let you understand how we are staying in line with the mission. So tonight we're going to be focusing on TORCH, which is Technical Outreach Community Help, and the pre-collegiate or pre-college initiative. Those are areas we're going to touch on tonight. So this is our program zone. And we also have what is called our special interest groups. So the special interest groups that we also are kind of touching on tonight will be healthcare innovation, because we are going to be speaking with Deputy Money, and we also are going to touch on public policy, a special interest group that looks at how NSBE should be engaged with public policy and how that affects us. All right, so we're going to start out with just kind of going back to, like I said earlier, keeping an eye on equity. A call for justice, we shall not be moved. Now, this is a calendar, if you will, a timeline of the things that we're actually doing in our chapter that will cover, you know, this theme. We kicked it off on Saturday with the MLK STEM Day with Cortex Robotics. And I just want to make sure Eric is on. Is Eric on? Eric, are you on yet? Because I'm going to have you. Okay, awesome. All right. And then on the 18th, National Day of Service, which is MLK Day, some of the teams will see one of the teams that is participating in the national conference is going to share a little bit tonight. So we had volunteers who have been working with those teams since December. So they continue to even serve. That's something that we do every week. So it wasn't anything different that we had to do. But we decided since we were out of school, let's go ahead and continue the meeting tonight, the 19th. And then on the 25th, we're going to talk about ethics and artificial intelligence. Okay. We have to make sure we don't have any bias in the AI that we're teaching our devices. And on the 28th, there's going to be a SAS. That last one is SAS. This one's also a SAS. We'll be talking about, we're supporting one of our NSBE members, rather, who is speaking on aligning data with purpose. So these are the things that we're doing to keep an eye on equity. All right. I do want to touch on one thing. One of our teams is actually on the call, and they need survey participants. And you may have already done this. If you haven't, it's not too late to get in. I'll put this in the chat. But we need you to take a pretest to help them out in their project that they're doing. In a few minutes, they'll talk about that. But basically, I'm going to put this in the chat. If you've decided you want to do it, maybe you said in the registration you didn't want to do it, you can still do it. We need probably about 10 more participants. So I put this in the chat so that you can do that as we listen. And then at the end of the meeting, we're going to have another link that I will put in the chat as the post test. So I'll do that in one moment. And next up, I'm going to ask Eric Liu to come and give us just a quick little update on what we did this weekend with the MLK STEM Day. This was a joint event with Cortex Robotics and NSBE Junior. And so with that, Eric, I'm going to stop sharing and pass the baton to you if you want to bring up something or however you want to proceed.
That sounds good. Thank you, Mr. Crowland. Sorry, it says I can't screen share right now.
All right, hold on one second. Let me get that fixed for you. You got it?
Oh, yeah, I got it now. Thank you. All right, so hi, my name is Eric, and I'm the outreach director at Cortex Robotics. And I'll give a little bit rundown about us a little bit later on. So we had this event on the 17th, Dr. Tony talked about this already, the MLK STEM Day. Around 30 people attended, which included a few members from NSBE Junior, as well as some other organizations that we work with, like KCSSU and a few community centers. So we all just got on a Zoom call and we had a quick presentation and a bunch of STEM-themed activities in honor of Dr. King. So in addition to this presentation, we also had breakout rooms. So a few examples, we broke this up by age. So elementary schoolers had a MLK themed Jeopardy. Middle schoolers got an introduction to code through an hour of code session. And high schoolers were able to take a STEM career test and they discussed STEM careers with some of the members of our team. So talking a little bit more about Dr. King, equity, and this event. So Dr. King was a big advocate for equal education for everyone. Here is a quote from him, and I won't read this through for the sake of time, but Cortex and NSBE Junior were both two organizations that really enable, I guess, more representation and education in STEM. Furthermore, on Dr. King and education, he was a strong supporter of education. He attended college at the age of 15 and earned his doctorate at just the age of 25. And he was really a big advocate for it. I think a little bit repetitive from before. And a little bit of us then. Cortex, we are a community high school robotics team in the Cary area, founded in 2014. We'd usually work on building and programming robots, but we also love spreading STEM in our community. So we're part of an organization called FIRST, which also has a lot of resources on equity, diversity, and inclusion. And a lot of our members, they joined at a very young age and building like little robots with Legos, and now they're building competition robots. And I guess, Dr. Tony, do you want me to talk about like the NSBE junior teams as well, or?
Sure. You're working on those as well, so go ahead and talk about those and how Cortex is involved in them.
Yeah, sure. So Cortex, we've been partnering with NSBE for the last, I think, few years now, and we've been supporting a few of these teams. So some of our members have taken time out of their week to help mentor FL Explore, Math Video Challenge, and Trimathlon teams. So that's the first, third, and fourth one. That's the Visionaries and Extraordinaries for FL Explore. The Math Video Challenge, that's the Imagineers, and Trimathlon, that would be the Exponentials. So yeah, we've been continuously working on them, and yeah. So I guess our next section is a Kahoot. So this is a really quick fun quiz that we ran at the event. I'll have to stop sharing for 1 second to get it set up. Wait, sorry. Should I run this right now or?
Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead. I think this will be a great, I learned a lot from Cortex this weekend about Dr. King, some stuff I didn't even know. So I'd like to see what you guys think as well. We'll do just a few of the questions, maybe about, I think you said about 7 to 10.
Yep. All right. I shortened it a little bit. So, All right. So I'll send a link here. And then it will ask for a code. So I'll just need to generate this really quick.
All right. And I will say while Eric is getting that together that we had about, I think it was about 30 participants. One of a retiree, one of my mentors, he is 91 years old. He might join. How he was involved and what social justice equity meant to him and those things. So it was a very good program. A very good program. All right. Whenever you're ready, Eric.
Yep. And yeah, if you guys want to go to kahoot.it, and I can actually, I'll show how to do that right now. This is like a classroom tool that some of my teachers actually use. So, I'll share my entire screen instead. Here we go. So I'll just start a new tab, kahoot.it. And then it'll ask for a game pin, which I forgot what it is. It is 3903401. So if you type that in and press enter, it'll ask you for a nickname. I'll put my name. And then if you put that there, then it'll pop up on my screen as well. So,
all right, can we get some volunteers to let us learn about Dr. King a little bit through Kahoot? Go ahead and get another browser up and go to that link and put in the code. Thank you, Justin. Who else do we have in there?
I think someone might have put the code in twice, but yeah, that's good.
Okay, we'll wait maybe another couple of seconds here. If anybody says wants us to hold on, please tell us.
Yeah, and I'll keep it unlocked, so I think you'll be able to join even after we start.
All right. I'm not going to play this time because I already know the answers.
Yeah.
Okay. Are we ready?
I'll get started. And just one more thing. I got rid of some of the easier questions, so these are just the hard ones. I'll get started now. And it won't show the question on your device, so you have to check on this Zoom as well. But if that's an issue, I'll read out the questions. All right, I'll get started now. And if you guys don't want to join, it'll still be open for that. All right, so our first question is, which two universities or colleges did Martin Luther King Jr. attend? All right. Dr. King attended Boston University and Morehouse College. And I'll go to the next question now. What subject did Dr. King study in college? So red is economics, blue is sociology, yellow is chemistry, and green is philosophy. Awesome. I think most of the people got right. It was sociology. Ooh. All right, for our next question, what did Dr. King become after he graduated college? Red is a school teacher, blue is a firefighter, yellow is a minister, and green is a banker. Ooh, yay. Everyone got it right. All right, we're halfway through. Who inspired Dr. King's belief in nonviolent activism? So red is Gandhi, blue is Martin Luther, yellow is Jeremy Bentham, and green is the Pope. Well, everyone got this one right as well. All right. Which historic movement did Dr. King lead in Montgomery, Alabama? So red is a boycott of goods sold at convenience stores. Blue is a demonstration outside of a elementary school. Yellow is a demonstration out of Birmingham City Hall. And green is a boycott of city buses. Ooh. Yeah, this was the Montgomery bus boycott. And three people have gotten three in a row, so that's great. Where did Dr. King give his I Have a Dream speech? So red is at the Lincoln Memorial, blue is at the Statue of Liberty, yellow is at the White House, and green is at the Bunker Hill Monument. Oh yeah, everyone got it right. It was at the Lincoln Memorial. Oh, congrats on getting six in a row, wow. What was the name of Dr. King's last speech? So red is I've been to the mountaintop, blue is I have a dream, yellow is after Vietnam, and green is a direct action. Yeah, his final speech was called I've Been to the Mountaintop. Okay, and this is the last question. In what year was the holiday officially observed in all 50 states? So this is Dr. King's Day. Red is the year 2000, blue is the year 1983, yellow is the year 2006, and green is the year 1994. Ooh, yeah, this was a tough question. MLK Day was only observed in all 50 states in the year 2000. So here's the podium. Congrats, Mr. Justin.
Awesome. Excellent.
Yep.
Well, thank you, Eric. That was wonderful. So I want to just commend Eric for being an outstanding outreach director for Cortex Robotics. Like I said, he is working with NSBE Jr. He's working with Garner Road Community Center. He's worked with KCSSU. He's working with the Chavis Heights Community Center in Raleigh. So he's definitely fulfilling the dream of Dr. King every week. And it just warms my heart to see the dream unfold when Eric, who is not Black, can sit here and teach us about Dr. King and embrace his vision and believe it. The event that we had on Sunday was a multicultural event. So I think that would be exactly what Dr. King would want to see. So give Eric some thumbs up, some hands, some kudos, some yays, some likes, and some shout outs in the chat for being so humble and willing to serve in that capacity. Thank you so much, Eric. You're welcome to stick around. I know you have homework to do, so if you have to go, if your parents say you got to go, I understand, but if you can stay, we'll be glad to have you. And what school do you go to, Eric?
I'm a sophomore at Panther Creek.
Okay, awesome. All right, thank you so much. Any final thoughts?
I just like to thank you for inviting me, and thank you everyone for the compliments. And I could not do this without my team, and I'm so proud that there's veterans who have guided me along the way, and there's so many people willing to help out. So yeah, unfortunately I'll have to drop out very soon, but it was really fun.
All right, thank you so much, Eric.
Thank you.
Awesome. All right, so let me go back to sharing. So what I'm going to do next is we're going to talk a little bit about equity. And also, let me mention this. If you just joined the call and you still want to take the pre-COVID-19 assessment, that's going to help out one of our teams. That link is in the chat. You may have to scroll up a little bit to get to it. If Doug, you see it and you can repost it in the chat, please go ahead and do it while we are going over this section. So just a little bit of a drum roll here. Let me get this going. We're going to talk about the difference between equity and equality. I would say that oftentimes we have heard people say, well, there was inequality and therefore we had the, you know, civil rights movement because there was inequality. Yeah, that's true. There was inequality. People wanted inequality. That's what we thought we wanted. But actually, that really evolved to equity, because when we got to equality, this is what equality looks like. And meaning that equality promotes fairness and justice by giving everyone the same thing. But you have to take into the full understanding of the history. That may not even be possible based on what has happened in prior years. So equity is about fairness. As you can see, this picture here shows that to get everybody to the same level, you have to make up for those differences and disadvantages. So here you see people with different heights here. So they are at disadvantages, you know, based on, you know, how close their feet are to the ground. So keep that in mind. I'm going to show you a couple of quick clips to help us better understand that and unfold on that a little bit more. All right, this first one is, let me see here. We're going to take a look at this one here. So this is a clip. Actually, let me share that again so you can hear it. So this is a clip from Dr. King talking about equity.
Give the Negro any land. Through an act of Congress, our government was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that it was willing to undergird its white peasants from Europe with an economic floor. But not only did they give the land, they built land-grant colleges with government money to teach them how to farm. Not only that, they provided county agents to further their expertise in farming. Not only that, they provided low interest rates in order that they could mechanize their farms. Not only that, today many of these people are receiving millions of dollars in federal subsidies not to farm, and they are the very people telling the black man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps. Now, this is what we are faced with, and this is a reality. Now, when we come to Washington in this campaign, we are coming to get our check.
Hi, YouTube. Welcome to the Anti-Racism Academy. I'm your host, Brandy Blacker Anderson, and I'm a triple Ivy League educated lawyer, teacher, activist, DEI consultant, and the mother of an adorable three-year-old named William. Today, we're going to listen to and unpack one of Dr. King's lesser-known speeches in which he discusses the role of white privilege in shaping the American economy. But before we dissect Dr. King's thoughts on white privilege, let's start by defining what it is. White privilege refers to the advantages white people receive based on their race. Put another way, white privilege is a byproduct of racism. While Black, Indigenous, and other people of color face disadvantages because of their race, white people do not face disadvantage because of their race. The following clip is a speech Dr. King gave in 1968, not long before his assassination, to a group of poor Black people in the rural South as a part of his effort to galvanize support for his Poor People's Campaign, aka the Poor People's March on Washington, which represented a shift in demands from civil rights to human rights for people of all races. Among the demands were universal employment, guaranteed income, and more low-income housing. As you watch this clip, listen to what Dr. King says about how the American government gave white people advantages in attaining the American dream. Comment below. Have you ever seen this footage?
I'm sorry, I was on mute. I don't think you guys heard some of it. Let me take it back a little bit.
At the very same time that America refused to give the Negro any land.
After the assassination of President Abraham Lincoln, the United States government broke its promise to provide recently freed Blacks with the land for their own farms. You may have heard of Special Order Field No. 15, aka the 40 Acres and a Mule Order, that was supposed to redistribute farmland from treasonous Confederate plantation owners to Black people as reparations for slavery. But Andrew Johnson shut that down when he took office less than 1 year after the order was issued.
Through an act of Congress, our government was giving away millions of acres of land in the West and the Midwest, which meant that it was willing to undergird its white peasants from Europe with an economic floor.
Enacted in 1862, during the Civil War, the Homestead Act provided that any adult citizen or intended citizen who had never borne arms against the U.S. government could claim 160 acres of surveyed government land. Between 1868 and 1934, the U.S. government granted 246 million acres of western land to well over 1.5 million white families for virtually free. Though some Black families received land, almost all of the land grants went to whites.
But not only did they give the land, they built land-grant colleges with government money to teach them how to farm.
These acts were known as the Morrill Land Grant Acts. The first was enacted during the Civil War in 1862, and the second in 1890. Which expanded this model of stealing indigenous land out west to provide for white people and institutions.
Not only that, they provided county agents to further their expertise in farming.
The Hatch Act of 1887 established a system of agricultural experiment stations in conjunction with each state's land-grant university. And later, the Smith-Lever Act of 1914 created a system of cooperative extensions to be operated by the universities to teach white farmers about developments in agriculture.
Not only that, they provided low interest rates in order that they could mechanize their farms.
In 1916, Congress passed the Federal Farm Loan Act, which created 12 federal land banks in the farm credit system to provide white farmers and ranchers with long-term loans and low interest rates.
Not only that, Today, many of these people are receiving millions of dollars in federal subsidies not to farm.
Starting in the 1920s, the U.S. government passed a number of laws which provided subsidies in the form of cash payments and price controls. These laws were intended to benefit white people only, while denying these same rights to black and other people of color.
And they are the very people telling the black man that he ought to lift himself by his own bootstraps.
Now, some of you may be saying, but he didn't say the words white privilege. That's true, but if you listen closely, he explains the many ways in which white privilege has been built into our laws. Many white folks will argue, my ancestors weren't in this country or never owned slaves, but they fail to acknowledge that they benefit from these legacies of oppression.
This is what we are faced with.
Dr. King closes with letting the audience know,
now when we come to Washington in this campaign, we are coming to get our check.
Meaning the Poor People's Campaign was going to urge the American government to afford all poor people the same benefits it gave to whites who benefited from the land grant acts and other laws I've covered in this video. Tragically, Dr. King was never able to realize this vision. People are so unaware of these histories, so they deny the existence of white privilege and whitewash Dr. King's legacy. You can be a part of the solution by liking this video and sharing it with your circles. And if you'd like to see more videos like this, please subscribe to this channel and power to the people. Fist bump the notification bell so you can stay up to date on our videos. This has been the Anti-Racism Academy, and I've been your host, Brandy Blocker Anderson. Thank you so much for watching.
At the very same time that
Okay, so I thought that might be just some quick little background information on why we have this problem of inequity and why it is so important for us to know the history behind it and what has happened and gotten us to this point. So I do have one other short clip if I can get this one to come up here. Let me see if I can find it. Are you guys hearing that? Thank you. you may have a sorry about that. You might need to use those videos to help you explain to a coworker or colleague what these inequities are. So I hope that was helpful, and we're just going to talk just for a few minutes on some of the things that we're doing with NSBE opportunities for us to help even the access in the playing field. So let me get back into sharing. All right. So the Social Justice Equity Initiative is something that NSBE kicked off last year as a reaction to what we saw happening with the events of George Floyd and the protests and the hashtag BLM movement. So here's some questions that we're going to address. Some of them we may not answer tonight, but these are some things that as NSBE members and those of our guests who want to also pay attention to this, here's some things that we need to be paying attention to, noticing and understand how to address. We'll talk through those. I'm going to ask our social justice equity ambassador. He's going to come on as well. The items that we have on the screen here is just a few of those things that NSBE has already put out there. So, Al, are you on?
I am. Let me get my video right.
Okay. I thought I had a, there we go. That's the slide that I wanted to bring up. So this is Al Leaston. Al, you want to do just a quick 30-second introduction?
Sure. So my name is Al Leaston, as Tony said. Let me see. I'm a NC State graduate, currently the program director at Wake Tech in the IT division. And I'm passionate about STEM and equity and diversity. So when Tony asked me to help out with the social justice piece of equity, I was excited to do that. So I'm actively engaged in other organizations as well and serving the community through NAACP and things of that nature. So I don't know how much Tony did want me to talk about it.
Oh, that's good. That's good. Yes. So right. I'll let you kind of, I know you've been doing a little research on what NSBE has been up to, and here's some links. Yep. We won't go through all of these. You know, do you want to share? Or do you want to just?
I can. Okay. Sure, go ahead. Well, I can just talk about what I found. And
okay.
Yeah. So, in looking at, as Tony has mentioned, the social justice piece. So NSBE does have a social justice piece to their website, which is up there now. A lot of things that were focused on were actions in 2020. That we probably still are very close to us and we need to be cognizant of, specifically around, you know, the things that were happening with George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, Ahmaud Arbery, and sort of their stance on that. Some things I know that we should look at, or I think we should look at as a community, is just how we can, in STEM specifically, how we can look to create a more diverse space. Also, we have so much things going on now. We just coming right out of MLK. We have the inauguration tomorrow. So some things that really just stuck out to me were just searching, you know, some of the policies that were currently in place that geared toward diversity, equity, and inclusion and social justice. I know there's some things going on, for instance, around the Safe Justice Act, which kind of eliminates racial disparities. So I know we probably need to be following different policies. The George Floyd Policing Act, which is something that's big on, hopefully on everybody's radar as we look to see how, you know, our newly elected president and Madam Vice President do. Some other just quick bullet points that that I kind of pay close attention to. Would be kind of our college affordability and student loan debt, things like that. Underfunding the minority serving institutions as far as HBCUs. I know that as far as NSBE, there's NSBE chapters at several, or I know a few HBCUs specifically, North Carolina A&T, which is a land grant institution, one of the two in North Carolina. I heard that from the video. There's some also just as I know in speaking, there's some things that we can do specifically to kind of be more active in social justice and specifically diversity, equity around Title IX things, equity and engineering. I know that there's always equity and engineering opportunities for STEM and things of that nature. So some things that I would have us to look out for are just what else is going on in the equity community with diversity, equity, inclusion. I think it's good for us to be aware of some of our things. Over the last year, I know I've done quite a bit of diversity training myself, and I think it helps everybody. You know, we sometimes look and think it helps just certain people and that we might not need it, but it made me aware of certain implicit biases, certain microaggressions that I might be using in my day-to-day activity with people. So I think as from a diversity inclusion aspect, it's something that we probably can all take advantage of and try to be more involved in. So that was really it, Tony. I didn't okay. have specifically, but awesome. You know, some things that I have been following. You know, we have the inauguration tomorrow, which is going to be big. Right. And then I know with what else is going on. William Barber is actually doing the press service Thursday at the Washington sure. National Cathedral.
Okay.
I think there's going to be a lot of, you know, a lot of good points made there about social justice and kind of where we are and some of the things we should be looking for starting off in 2021.
Awesome. And just a sidebar, I know that some people just joined. Thank you for those who are, who did take the survey. If you can post that pretest in there, we're getting our numbers up. This is to help out the students who are going to present and talk a little bit in a moment. But back to what we're talking about here, I'll send this out. I won't go through all these links, but these are some good links. You guys will get a copy of this. Something to be very conscious about is surviving and resisting hate. That really weighs on you emotionally and mentally. So NSBE provided some resources on how to, you know, manage that, how to cope with just being around hate and the things that might add extra stressors in your life. Like we saw what happened on the 6th. Like that was very stressful for quite a few of us. So just how do we manage that and how do we take care of ourselves through that? And just in summary, though, a call to action. Here's some things that we can be doing individually. First of all, as NSBE members, you can support our mission through the programs that we already have. We have community partners that are helping us to try to get more equity in education. And we really are pushing STEM because that's where the jobs are. We have shortages now and we'll continue to have shortages in the future. So we can't afford not to include everybody. I mean, we need every capable human being who can do a STEM job be doing it. We just can't afford to leave anybody out. Like we all lose if we don't have enough professionals. The other thing is community forums, public policy, and understanding your jurisdiction. So I posted up here. You can get this information off of the State Board of Elections. Know your jurisdiction, who is representing you, and what they stand for. You know, everyone you selected might not win. So you have to know who's representing you. Even if you didn't vote for that person, they're still representing you. That doesn't mean you don't communicate with them. So they will be voting on things that affect you, and you need to let them know your opinions and your preferences. So you need to know how to reach out to them. So we have here information on how to reach your House of Representatives person and your senators. You need to let them know how you want them to represent you in Washington on some of the policies that the Biden-Harris administration is going to be putting forth. You can also go out to these sites as well and put in a video and send that to the Biden-Harris administration, letting them know your thoughts and things you would like to see them do. So here are some good links, and you'll be able to go to these once we send out this information. All right. So up next, we're going to kind of segue into our next segment here, which is looking at equity in healthcare access. But before we do that, though, we are going to have our NSBE Junior Technical Innovation Competition team called Team Immunity. They want to say a few things. This is the team that we need the survey for. So if you haven't done that, you still want to get one in. This is a part of a project that they're participating in. These students are in high school, and I'm going to ask them to go ahead and chime in. Lauren and Breland, are you on?
Hi, yes, I'm on.
Okay, awesome. And just real quick, Lauren, introduce yourself, and then Breland, do the same. Just let us know your school, your grade, and what you want to do when you go to college, what you want to major in, what you want to be when you grow up.
Hi, good evening, everyone. I'm Lauren Lascano. I'm a junior at Heritage High School, and I hope to study biology as my major in college and go into healthcare.
And Breland?
Okay, hi, everybody. My name is Breland McDonald. I'm a sophomore at Wake Early College of Health and Science, and I don't know what I want to major in, but I know I want to go into a pre-med track.
Awesome. And is there anything you want to tell us just kind of in a few minutes about your project and why it interests you?
Yes. So we want to pursue this project because COVID vaccines have come out recently, and we want to make sure that people are making informed decisions about what's best for them. And in minority groups, there have been medical mistrust in the past, especially in Henrietta Lacks and Tuskegee situations. And I also want to see the impact that those events had on these communities. And what we hope to achieve with this project is to make information more available to the general public and also find the information that is needed to assure the general public of the safety of the vaccine.
Awesome. And Breland, is there anything that you want to add to that?
Like Lauren said, there is a lot of mistrust within not only the Black community, but the POC community. And I wanted to join this project to research more about the mistrust and why we put so little trust in our healthcare system and why this vaccine is making a lot of people wary of whether to get it or not. So that was my main reason for joining.
Awesome. Well, thank you, ladies. I think it's wonderful for what you're doing, and you're going to have the privilege of hearing Deputy Money here shortly. And I'll just kind of say one more time, the survey process is going to be a pretest. So if you haven't taken it, go ahead and get it in if you still want to. Then we're going to ask you to do it again so these ladies can use this results of this as a part of their research. They want to see if what you hear tonight is going to change your opinion based on the information that's shared. So at any rate, next I'm going to ask Kirsten Ingram. She has also been helping us with these young ladies and been coaching them as well. I'm going to ask her to go ahead and introduce our speaker for tonight. Kirsten, are you there?
I am. Thank you, everyone.
Awesome.
Thank you, Tony. In transitioning into our speaker, Deputy Money, thank you, Deputy Money, for coming and being with us and sharing information in regards to COVID-19 vaccinations, where we are with things in regards to the COVID-19 vaccination process, as well as the rollout of the vaccination. And to give you a little bit of background in regards to Deputy Money, he began in the Department of Health and Human Services in 2019 as the Deputy Secretary for Health Services. He previously served as the President and Chief Executive Officer of the North Carolina Community Health Center Association, serving the 41 community health centers in the state. He led them in a 10-year period of unprecedented growth in organizations, clinical sites, and patients served. In his role, Deputy Money was a member of the boards of the North Carolina Institute of Medicine, the North Carolina Healthcare Quality Alliance, the North Carolina Health Information Exchange Advisory Board, the North Carolina Safety Net Advisory Council, the CareShare Health Alliance, and the Public Health Practice Advisory Committees for both the East Carolina Brody School of Medicine and the Gilling School of Global Public Health at the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill. So without further ado, I pass the baton over to Deputy Money.
Thank you so much, Kirsten. I really appreciate the opportunity. And Tony, thank you again for the invitation to speak with you. What I want to do is I've got a brief presentation I want to give just to give you an update on the vaccine. So if I can, I will share my screen. And then I want to really utilize the time to take questions that you have, because I know that there are a lot of questions about vaccine, you know, what we're doing in terms of rolling it out. And I want to make sure that that you have time to get those questions asked. And I will do my best to either give you an answer or find an answer and send it to you after the presentation. One of the things I want to do right now is just do a slideshow so you can see it. Okay. And so I'd ask Kirsten, if you wouldn't mind, any questions that come up in the chat, if you would just be minding the chat, and you know, I can go ahead and answer the questions after the presentation, and also anything that comes up that I'm not able to address, you know, if you could send that to me so I can find the answer and get back to you. Want to just remind us all that we're in the midst of a pandemic. It's colder, people are more inside. We know that COVID is a respiratory virus, so it's an advantageous time for the virus to spread. And it was just a year ago Monday that we had the first indication of COVID-19 in North Carolina, and thus far we're at 684,000 cases. Right now, we're seeing cases at a rate of about 4,000 a day. So when you think about that, that's a significant number of people that are being infected. Currently, there are 3,881 that are hospitalized. Thus far, we've had over 8,000 deaths. And our current positivity rate, that is number of tests that come back positive, is at 11.8%. So we're really at the one of the highest parts of the pandemic, and actually the highest part that we've seen thus far. So when we look at you know, our current hospitalizations, we see that they've gone up since before the Christmas holidays, and that our 24-hour admission has gone up. But one of the things that we've seen in the last few days is it's actually starting to decline a little bit. We're hoping that we've gone past that Christmas and New Year surge that we were anticipating. Usually our hospital figure is, we call it a lagging indicator, because it tends to be behind cases. You have cases first, and then those cases progress to hospitalizations. And then really from the start of the pandemic, we can really see the disproportionate impact on communities of color. It was immediately seen early on in the pandemic. And over time, through focusing our testing and our prevention efforts in communities of color, we call them historically marginalized communities, we've begun to somewhat even it out to the point where it's closer to the population demographics of North Carolina. So North Carolina, we have 22% African American, and the COVID case rate's 20% over the course of the pandemic. But we know that early on it hit our populations disproportionately high, to a large extent due to the fact that many of the frontline essential workers are overrepresented in communities of color, African Americans, Hispanic, Latinx, Native Americans, are in positions, jobs, where they can't socially distance themselves from the people they have to see on a daily basis. More people, different people, increasing their risk of exposure. see for the Hispanic population that their case rate is actually higher than their population percentage, which is about 9%, and their case rate is at 23%. And we saw early on around the late spring and early summer, disproportionately high number of cases in Hispanic Latinx populations, particularly in meat processing and poultry plants where we had early cases and significant outbreaks. What we see in terms of the death rate, though, is the death rate for African Americans is actually higher than our percentage in the population. For Native Americans, about the same. And for Hispanic Latinx, it's about at the population rate. So the disproportionate impact of deaths from COVID really has hit the African American population particularly hard, and you know, continues to do so. One of the things that we've done across the state is really looked at how that impact of the growing number of cases as well as impact to health systems is dispersed across North Carolina. And when we first developed this this county alert system, you know, slightly over half of the counties were in red. Now the majority of counties are in red. And that is an indication of the case rates within the counties, the percent of tests that come back positive, as well as the strain on the hospitals, you know, how many beds they have, as well as how many individuals are in the intensive care unit. So as a result, Secretary Cohen issued a secretarial directive, and the governor extended the modified stay-at-home order through January 29th. The secretarial directive essentially said, you know, because of widespread community transmission, because of the spread of COVID-19 across North Carolina, we're really urging people to stay at home except for essential activities, avoid gathering, getting together with people that aren't in your household, particularly indoors. And we've also increased the amount of benefits that people can receive that receive food nutrition service benefits. So as was mentioned earlier in the presentation, those videos are really excellent. Equity has really got to be a framework of what we do because we've seen so much historic inequity, whether it is wealth creation, land opportunities, opportunities for education, opportunities for advancement. We've seen so much inequity built through historic racism and systemic discrimination in this country. And healthcare is no exception. As was mentioned by the students, there are many examples of systemic violence and abuse of Black and brown bodies by the American healthcare system for medical experimentation, for lack of services and resources, for the exploitation of people for profit. And so it's quite understandable that there's a significant amount of mistrust as it pertains to the COVID vaccine. COVID vaccine was developed in the backdrop of an administration that demonstrated inequity, that presented the COVID pandemic as insignificant, and presented the opportunities that that existed for the development of the vaccine in a way that made people very skeptical. The concept of Operation Warp Speed created doubt, it created cynicism, created a great deal of mistrust. So with that backdrop, the development of the vaccine had some negative connotations coming right out of the gate. And so it's been really important for us at DHHS to have conversations like the one we're having tonight, where we're sharing what we know about the vaccine, sharing what we're doing about getting the vaccine out to communities, and really listening and getting your guidance and your expertise on how we can do a better job in our work. So, as I mentioned before, there's a lot of historic examples of where healthcare has used and abused Black and brown bodies. And I think the difference with the COVID vaccine from the Tuskegee experiment or the Henrietta Lacks exploitation of her stem cells in developing this vaccine is that Black and brown people have been involved in the development of the vaccine. They've been involved in key research, and they've been at the table in reviewing the science, reviewing the literature, and coming to their own conclusions. The vaccine was developed quickly in a 9-month period because scientists really did have a head start. They were working on the techniques for years. And the person you see to the left is Dr. Kizmikia Corbett. She's a viral immunologist with the National Institutes of Health. She led a team and continues to lead a team that developed the clinical trials. A lot of our research for 6 years was used to develop the RNA method that was used to simulate the spike protein on the coronavirus molecule that actually teaches the body how to develop immunity. Proud to say that she's from North Carolina, and her research really led to the development of the Moderna vaccine, one of the two vaccines that's currently available. It's important to know that the vaccine has rolled out in North Carolina, as I'm sure you all know, and that everyone is going to have the opportunity to get it, and they're going to be able to get it for free. As I said before, not only did scientists have a head start, but there were also thousands of volunteers that participated in the clinical trials. Normally, there's usually about 1,000 or so for clinical trials. In this case, we had 10 times the amount. There were over 70,000 volunteers participated in the clinical trials for the COVID and Moderna vaccine. And it's important to know that these vaccines are really going to be the way for us to get past this pandemic. People are concerned about how it was manufactured. Recognize that the findings of the clinical trials are available on the Food and Drug Administration's website, that they are publicly available, and that scientists of all groups have actually taken a concerted effort to really examine the literature and decide for themselves that the vaccine's safe. It's important to note that there's no live or killed COVID-19 that's in the vaccine. That while the federal government invested early on in the development of the vaccine and actually purchased the initial quantity to assure that when the FDA and the Centers for Disease Control approved its use through emergency use authorization, that there would be supplies available. But supplies are limited at first. There's only two manufacturers right now, but we're putting provisions in place in North Carolina to make sure everyone does have a spot where they can get their shot, their vaccine. To date, the vaccines have been proven 95% effective in preventing COVID-19. That was demonstrated during the phase 3 clinical trials, and that research is still ongoing. There were no serious safety concerns in the clinical trials, and most people that had a reaction had a temporary reaction, like a sore arm or headache or feeling tired or achy for a day or two. Something that you would experience if you had, for example, a shingles vaccine. I had that last year, and I experienced those same type of symptoms. But, you know, it was quite worthwhile to have that because, you know, the comfort of knowing that I'm protected from shingles and how painful that condition is, was well worth just feeling lousy for a day after the vaccination. As I mentioned before, there has been a concerted effort to recruit volunteers from historically marginalized populations. And you can see from the pie chart for both the Pfizer and the Moderna vaccine that there was, I think, significant representation, more than you would see in a standard vaccine trial, to recruit people of African-American and Hispanic Latinx descent in those trials. So, and this may be a little bit elementary, but, you know, just for background, the way this messenger RNA vaccine works is it actually creates a blueprint, if you will, for your body to make the antibody just for the spike protein. And it's that spike protein that the antibodies, once they're made, attach to neutralize the virus. So the antibody doesn't make a protein for the entire virus. So you're not recreating COVID in your body, just that spike protein. And it's a multivariant spike protein. So there are different types of spike proteins on the virus. The antibody that gets produced in the messenger RNA actually works on different types of spike proteins. I think that question comes up when people hear about the variants that are emerging, the variant from the UK, variant from South Africa, Brazil. What we know thus far is that the COVID-19 vaccine is effective on those. Now, we also know that viruses mutate. That's what they do. So this virus, just like the flu virus, is going to change over the next months and years. And so we anticipate that just like with the flu, there needs to be a new flu vaccine developed and administered every year. Most scientists believe that, and public health officials believe that the COVID vaccine will also be an annual vaccination. You know, will it be blended into the flu vaccine? I don't know. I don't think so. But we are monitoring it. Recognize the fact that the vaccine was just in the state right before Christmas. And it's just started being administered across the country. Right now, I think there's pretty close to 7 or 8 million people who have gotten the vaccine thus far. And so the monitoring of those individuals is still underway. In other words, that phase 3 clinical trial is still ongoing. We also know that the Pfizer and Moderna vaccine require 2 shots, so it becomes a little bit more logistically complicated in terms of administering the vaccine. There's also storage requirements, particularly with the Pfizer vaccine for ultra cold storage. And that second shot needs to come for the Pfizer vaccine 3 weeks after administration of the first one and 4 weeks after the administration of the first Moderna vaccine. So it's important that people get both doses. We also in the state have built a vaccine management system to help make sure that people get the right vaccines and are not mixing type. They need to get the right type of vaccine and get the dose at the right time. So that system is being put in place. And that's where we're really tracking how many vaccines come into the state, where they're being distributed to, and how quickly they're being administered. So as I mentioned before, you know, this research hasn't happened in the dark. In fact, because of past discrimination and abuses and medical violence, to be quite honest, many historically Black colleges and university medical schools, as well as National Medical Association, NAACP, and others, conducted their own investigation of the research to draw their own conclusions and encourage African Americans and people of color, everyone really, to get that COVID vaccine. This is a little bit dated, stating it's 5.9 million. We're at a clip in North Carolina right now, given about 32,000 doses a day. So when you look at the national figures, it's constantly increasing as well, which gives us more information about the vaccine. I know that everyone has their own reason for wanting the vaccine. It's created a great deal of desire, but then it's also, for some, created or still left some hesitancy, some skepticism. And we're really trying to work with communities, particularly those organizations and individuals that have an opportunity to get the vaccine early, to go ahead and do so, particularly those workers in long-term care facilities and in healthcare systems that are at high risk of exposure to COVID. So it's important to know that while we're tracking where the vaccine goes to make sure that all of it is used and none of it's wasted, there's nothing in the vaccine that actually tracks itself in you. It disappears once the messenger RNA does its job. The other components within the vaccine are, you know, lipids, some fat, some sugar, and a little bit of salt. So it's salinated with your body. So the information that we do collect, any of the personal identified information is protected and it's not shared with the federal government or anyone else. We don't send that information off. That's North Carolina public health law. I said before, the vaccines are going to be free. We're going to have more supply, particularly as two additional vaccines look to be going to the FDA for emergency use authorization in the next month. That'll increase our supply. With all the vaccines, federal government has purchased them. They're going to be free to everyone, even if you don't have insurance. There are some insurance companies that are billing the providers that are billing insurance companies for the administrative fee, but no one should be charged directly for the COVID vaccine, and everyone will have a spot to get it. So you probably know that last week, the Centers for Disease Control changed their prioritization schedule, and we did as well. We are working under the guidance of the North Carolina Institute of Medicine and their Vaccine Advisory Committee. And we utilize the Centers for Disease Control as a reference for their framework. And so we've actually simplified the prioritization. And again, this is really based on risk of exposure to COVID and risk of severe illness if one contracts COVID. So when we think about risk of exposure, healthcare workers that are directly working with COVID patients have the highest risk. But given widespread transmission in the state, you can really say that all healthcare workers are exposed. And then long-term care staff and residents, particularly because of the outbreaks we've seen in long-term care facilities and the importance it is for both staff and residents to be protected. The residents are at the most severe risk of severe illness, and in many instances, staff, because of the nature of the work that they do, are at risk of illness as well, because we find that many long-term care staff, they're overrepresented by people of color, often low income, and so it's important that they have the protections that they need. Next up is older adults over 65 years of age. And both of these are active groups right now. So our health departments, our health systems, and their partners are actively involved in vaccination efforts. We'll be moving from those two groups. And these lines are always open. So if you're a healthcare worker in phase one, you're always going to be eligible to get the vaccine. It's not like one phase closes and another one opens up. They all stay open. So the third group would be frontline essential workers. And we're currently putting greater clarity and definition into what those terms mean, really focused again on risk of exposure and risk of severe illness. And then the fourth group are adults at high risk for exposure and increased risk of severe illness. And then that fifth group is really everyone else. So that's the new and updated prioritization schedule. As I said before, the focus right now is on healthcare workers and the elderly. And so we have established a COVID-19 line at 1-877-490-6642. And we've also established a website that links to our website, yourspotyourshot.nc.gov. These will link you to the direct phone numbers for local health departments or the hospitals that have the vaccine. And we're currently onboarding federally qualified health centers to provide vaccinations, particularly to our historically marginalized communities. That's really a big part of their focus. So to date, and I pulled this off of our website this afternoon, 344,000 individuals received their first dose, and then there's 60,000 of those that actually completed the vaccine series, that two vaccination series. And this information doesn't include the vaccines that go through the federal long-term care program. So the federal government is actually handling the vaccination of long-term care residents and staff. They're doing it through a contract with CVS and Walgreens. And what we know thus far is that 54,385 doses have been administered through the federal program. Most first dose, they're starting second dose next week. This chart is troubling. It's troubling because what it reflects right now is the fact that a lot of our healthcare workforce is predominantly white. A lot of the emphasis that we have on getting vaccines out and speed are going to communities that aren't African-American communities. And we're actively changing that. We are actively getting vaccines into the hands of federally qualified health centers, actively standing up mass vaccination sites in historically marginalized communities, and actively working with partners in the communities to make sure that African-Americans, Hispanic, Latinx, other peoples of color, other people that are in, you know, these that have been disproportionately impacted by COVID have the opportunity to get the vaccine early. We're concerned about vaccine hesitancy. We're really working hard to get the message out about how the vaccine has been reviewed and the safety aspects of it, and to make sure that those messengers that are delivering those messages reflect the communities. And you can see, based on ethnicity, that we really haven't scratched the surface with the Hispanic Latinx population as well. So one thing is important to know, and this really plays a factor in this whole vaccine rollout, is that the federal government actually decides how much vaccine each state gets based on its population. And then it's up to North Carolina to determine where that vaccine goes. Now, recognize that the majority of the vaccine, well, there's only two types of vaccine right now. The Pfizer vaccine was the majority of the vaccine that came out early. It has a very fragile shelf life, and it requires cold storage. So there were only a handful of sites that we could ship it to. And the way they package it, it comes in packages of 900 doses. So whoever gets it has got to be able to vaccinate a large number of people. Because once you break that package and you open it up, you have a very short window of time to actually administer the vaccine. And it's important that we don't waste any vaccine. So we really had to be very strategic in terms of who got the vaccine. Federal government also has put rules on how many times you can reallocate that vaccine. So when they ship it, when the manufacturer ships it, after we determine where it goes, the providers that have that vaccine know that they've got to store it appropriately and they can only reallocate it once. So let's say that vaccine is at a hospital and that hospital determines that they've got enough and there's a fairly qualified health center that needs the vaccine. Well, actually, let's say it's a rural health center because we already have the federally qualified health centers, at least half of them getting their vaccine allocations directly. So right now, the rural health clinics don't. So let's say it's a rural health clinic and a hospital says, we want to give 100 doses to a rural health clinic because they said that they're going to have a vaccine event. Well, if that rural health clinic sets up their vaccine event and only 50 people show up, they can't then send the other 50 doses, the remaining 50 doses, either back to the hospital or to another provider. You can only transfer it once. So we've got to be very effective in our ability to anticipate where vaccines are going to be needed, encouraging vaccine providers to set up appointments, and to set up appointments to the point where they're likely to run out. Because, you know, while it's inconvenient for someone if we do run out, it's important that we don't waste vaccine because there is a limited supply. And so we're really focused this week in particular on speed, because the federal government has also said in their monitoring of how vaccines are administered by states, they're going to penalize states that don't get vaccines administered quickly. So we really have to focus on balancing speed, but balancing it with equity so that we're focused on equity. We don't want to be penalized in this race to get vaccines in arms, but right now that is our priority. That's why it's important for us to convey this message about where people can go to find out about where they can get a vaccine, to where to call to get an appointment for the vaccine, and to make sure that they have access to that. And one of the challenges that we know is that so much of this communication actually happens via the internet. A lot of older people, a lot of people of color don't have internet access. They don't have, in many instances, the ability to wait on the phone, you know, for an extended period if call lines are clogged. And so what we've seen and what we saw in that chart showing disparities of people is also that a disproportionate number of older people that are white have the means and the access to be able to get a vaccine, and we want to make sure that people of color aren't crowded out. So that's why an overemphasis on trying to put vaccination sites and resources in communities of color. It's important also that we get out information through a variety of means. So we're doing news conferences, social media, our website, but most importantly, trusted community leaders. And I want to ask you all, and I'm going to do this a couple of times in this presentation, if you would be conveyors of this information, if you'd be willing to, as individuals, go through a brief training on how to present this information and be able to get regular reminders, regular updates on our vaccine plans so you can share those with your stakeholders and communities. Because we want to really make sure that there's no disparity in access and availability to get this vaccine. Here's some examples of some of the materials that we've put out, PSAs. We even have a method for folks to record their own videos of their desire to get the vaccine or even themselves getting the vaccine. A lot of frequently asked questions that we update on a regular basis. But it's also important for us to recognize, as I said in the very beginning, we're in the midst of a pandemic. So the vaccines, while they're being rolled out, aren't going to alleviate COVID-19 right away. We're still going to need to practice the 3 W's, waiting, washing, and wearing a face covering, and particularly to avoid being in contact with people that don't live in your household until this pandemic subsides. So we do really need your help. Help us get this information out. Ask us the questions, particularly the hard questions, so that we can, if we don't have those answers right off the, available right away, we can go back and research the information, because we want to make sure that people have confidence in the vaccine, that they get their questions responded to, and that they are ready and able to get a vaccine when it's their turn, to know that they have a spot when it's their time to get that shot. So I want to use this as an opportunity to answer any questions that you have. I put a few resources in the chat, and in the appendix of this presentation, and I'll make it available to you after our call tonight.
All right, thank you, Deputy Money. That was excellent. I know Kirsten has been tracking the questions, and we've been kind of looking at that together. So, Kirsten, do you want to go ahead and chime in on some of those questions?
Awesome. Thank you, Tony. Thank you, Deputy Money, for sharing such an invaluable and informative presentation in regards to COVID-19 and the vaccination process. A few of the questions that came up during the chat include, what are the differences between the different approved vaccines?
Yep. So the both of the vaccines that are available right now use a messenger RNA technology. They use some different approaches. They have slightly different lipids and sugars and salts within them to make them, you know, distinct. But essentially, the essence of them, they are pretty much the same. The difference with the Moderna is it doesn't require that ultra cold storage. The second dose happens a week later than the Pfizer vaccine. But both are two-dose products.
Thank you. Another question we received is, what are the components that comprise the vaccine?
That's a good question, and I've got a little cheat sheet because I thought somebody might want to ask me that. So the Pfizer vaccine, based on its emergency use authorization, has the mRNA. That's that real. That's that active ingredient that teaches your body how to make the how to identify the spike protein and make the antibody for it. It also contains lipids, potassium chloride, monobasic potassium phosphate, sodium chloride, dibasic sodium phosphate dehydrate, and sucrose. The Moderna vaccine also has messenger RNA. It has lipids, thromethane hydrochloride, acetic acid, sodium acetate, and sucrose.
Awesome, thank you. Another one of our attendees wanted to know, what is in the vaccine that will cause it to expire?
The messenger RNA. That's the most fragile component of the vaccine. And again, it needs that cold storage. And one of the concerns about that whole transfer aspect is the risk of temperatures rising above the level of stability, rendering the vaccine either ineffective or less than ideally effective.
Awesome. Now, the next set of questions are in regards to the handling of the vaccination as well as receiving the vaccination. One member wanted to know, would the mishandling of the vaccination or the vaccine decrease the efficacy, if it's not stored properly?
That's correct. It would. Yes.
And another question is, at this point, do experts think that COVID-19 is going to be like the flu, changing every year and needing a new vaccination yearly?
Yes.
Okay. Another question we received is, what behaviors can the hard-hit demographics change to prevent contracting COVID-19?
Wearing a face covering, only going out as absolutely necessary, minimizing time with people that are outside of your household, as well as being sure to, you know, wash hands very frequently. Those are really the key measures, and particularly the face covering.
And Deputy Money, I asked that question. I want to just point something out. I think people take what you just said, but if they know somebody, they just forget everything you just said.
Yeah, and I think that was one of the challenges that we faced. And I remember coming and speaking to you before the holidays, really cautioning people to not gather with individuals that are outside of their household. You know, when you think about, like, I'll give you an example. My son and daughter came home from college, and what they both did was they tested when they left. Prior to leaving, and then quarantined while they were home. So we wore masks in the house until that quarantine period of time ended, when all of us took our masks off and we all got tested before we all came together. But I think when people, you know, see, well, that's my grandma, that's my aunt. You know, I can't not give her a hug. I can't not give her, I can't not be in her house if she's inviting me in. And, right. you know, we, one of the things we find is that a lot of the spread is through people that, you know, are familiar with each other, right. that may even live in the same household, but work in different areas, and, you know, contract, the virus gets contracted through, you know, known individuals.
People you know locally. So going to funerals, weddings, yes. birthday parties, baby showers, those things, I know a lot of people are still doing.
Yeah, they are. And one of the things that we're finding, let me share my screen for a minute here, because I put something up based on one of the questions that that she'd asked. Hang on a second, I'm gonna pull it up real quick. I don't know if you can you all see this? Okay.
Yes.
So this this slide here actually shows our cluster report. And one of the things that you can see in most cases aren't identified as a cluster, which, you know, is two or more in a setting. But one of the things, if you look at community and living events, we've had 2,162 people that were infected, known infected, through a religious gathering, 426 known infected through social gatherings. So social gatherings, religious settings, and that includes, like, you know, funerals, parties and other events. While they don't, this chart doesn't encompass every case in which someone contracted COVID as a result of those gatherings. These are the known cases. And you can see it's a significant number of known cases from these type of gatherings. So I think the evidence is pretty clear that being in these settings where people aren't wearing face coverings, they aren't social distancing, particularly if it's indoors, really increases your risk of contracting COVID. And may I also say that the thing that we know about these variants is that while the variant appears to be, while the vaccine appears to be effective on the variants are more contagious than regular COVID. And what we anticipate is that while the variant, you know, hasn't even been detected yet in North Carolina, by March, it will likely be the predominant strain, probably the UK variant will be the predominant strain by March in the United States. And what that means is we'll have a more contagious virus. So people will need to be even more mindful of their gatherings with people that they don't live with, be more mindful of wearing a face covering and the amount of time that they spend in settings that are outside of their home. If not, we could see another spike in cases come springtime.
Thank you. Go ahead, Kirsten.
Awesome. Thank you. And actually, I was looking at the question, Tony, that you answered in the chat.
People that work in meat and poultry plants are low wage. They tend to live in congregate housing where they are, you know, multi-families in one dwelling, so greater risk of transmission. They also share rides to the meat processing plants. And then when they get there, they're working side by side with little physical separation. So all those environments created an opportunity for COVID to be readily transmissible. We did a lot of work in testing, and the poultry and meat processing plants did work in creating some physical separation, you know, some plastic shields between employees. And so if you look at the outbreaks, I don't have a chart with me in this presentation, but what you'll see is we really started to lower to a significant degree the amount of outbreaks that occurred in those settings because of aggressive work early on.
Awesome, thank you. A few of the other questions we had are in regards to the vaccination process. One question we have by Dr. Marion Thompson Johnson is in which many of those on the call may remember she shared some information during the first and second presentations we had in regards to COVID-19. Thank you for joining us, Dr. Thompson. Many of her church members have had difficulties making appointments. It took her 2 hours to be on hold to get an answer. Are there plans to decrease the telephone wait time so that individuals do not lose patients in trying to obtain an appointment?
Yes, and in fact, our goal is to have a unified call center up and operational by the 1st of February. We're working very rapidly on standing that up. And again, I think that, you know, is just another example of how people that have greater access can position themselves to get the vaccine first. So it really is a huge equity issue. And know that we're rapidly working to resolve that.
And it reminds me of the conversation I had with one of my community partners earlier today. And they were talking about how inundated their system was in regards to phone calls for the vaccination. And my colleague's response to me, and I just had to, all I could do was laugh. She was saying how members were calling personally to them and saying, can't you get me ahead of that line, like the vaccination hookup? Mm-hmm. And so, you know, just even in addressing that and putting that out there in the atmosphere that there's no vaccination hookups, everyone has to go through the same process in the same system. And even how community members were finding different phone numbers for that organization and calling those phone numbers trying to get an appointment.
Wow.
Yeah, I even heard of an event over the weekend where it was in a predominantly Black community and white people basically jumped the line.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
So.
I'm sorry.
That
image, when you said that, just reminded me of the contrast between the Black Lives Matter movement and what we just saw earlier this month, and that whole juxtaposition, how all of that plays into the system mistrust.
Privilege.
Exactly, yeah. And access. If you have a prepaid phone and you have so many minutes, you can't afford to stay online waiting for somebody to pick up. But if you got an unlimited plan, or you've got a landline and you got a cell phone and your sister's got a cell phone, you can just ring all the numbers and sit there till somebody picks up. It's clearly access. Right. Yeah. Or if you can go online and schedule yourself in because you have internet access and a high speed. Yeah. It's a clear example of, you know, disparity, the haves and the have nots. Mm-hmm. And Tony, to your example of equity and equality, you know, we're trying to build the equity piece in by shifting a lot of the vaccine events, the mass events, to communities of color. But we got to make sure those communities of color
come out,
have access to getting the appointment, right?
Exactly.
And we're trying to really discouraging providers from doing events where they don't have appointments.
Right.
Particularly as we're really focusing on the priority populations, because the thing you don't want is for somebody to, you know, wait in line and show up and they're 63 years of age and you said, oh, you need to be 65. And then, you know, they start exerting themselves, let's just put it that way, whether it's their privilege or their power or their position, and start to create a scene when people are trying to give shots to folks.
Right. And just to, I want to make sure we get our post-test out there. How many more questions do we have, Kirsten? How many more you got in?
We have about six, and then the few points that I was going to share on the slides.
Okay. If you can go ahead and grab, I guess, maybe some of the most, I guess, critical questions, because I want to make sure people will get their post-survey in, too.
Okay. And I'll be happy to answer the other ones after the call.
Sure.
Thank you. One question we have is, will the components that make up the vaccine have any type of allergic reaction for some people?
So there is a vaccine, and I actually put that in the slide deck too. There's two systems that the federal government is actually utilizing to monitor the vaccine and its safety. And let me share my screen again one more time so I can show you these. Okay, hang on one quick second.
And as Deputy Money is doing that, if you could please, you can go ahead and start taking the post survey. I think you have a wealth of information. There'll be other questions that will continue to get answered, but you should be able to go ahead and do the post.
Yeah, so one is this V-Safe After Vaccine Health Checker. It's available for people that have taken the vaccine, so they can record any temporary side effects that they have, any reactions they have. And then the CDC also has this vaccine adverse event reporting system. This is more a provider-based system, but again, they're actively monitoring the number of incidents of the adverse reactions to the vaccine. I also want to just let you know that there was a recent article in the CDC's Morbidity and Mortality Weekly Report, and it was reporting from December 14th to 23rd, 2020. In their monitoring of the 1.9 first doses of the Pfizer vaccine, that there was only 21 cases of anaphylaxis, and 71 of those occurred within the first 15 minutes after the vaccine, after the vaccination. So that's why they have you wait until after you've gotten the vaccine 15 minutes before you leave, so that there is not an anaphylactic event. And typically that's resolved through a dose of epinephrine, so an EpiPen, but you know, that really resulted in just a small number of cases. Again, 21 cases out of 1.9 million doses. I'm happy to put that link in the chat as well. I'll do that.
Thank you. I'm not sure how many additional questions we have time for. But another question we have is, what happens if a person has COVID-19 without their knowledge and they receive the vaccination?
Okay, that's a really good question. Typically, we're not testing people prior to the vaccine, because if you're not symptomatic, typically it's not going to impact you. One of the things that we do know is that the natural immunity wears off in about 90 days. And as long as a person is not actively exhibiting symptoms, the COVID vaccine can actually help build their immunity. So we're encouraging people that have been vaccinated, that have been exposed to COVID, to get the vaccine, and to also get both doses of the vaccine.
Awesome. And speaking of both doses of the vaccine, what happens if someone receives one dose of the vaccine, but they're not able to get the second shot? And conversely, will the states run out if they do receive the first shot?
So here's what happens. When someone gets the first dose, the state automatically allocates the second dose to that provider. So as long as they go back to that provider where they got the first dose, there should be a second dose waiting for them. And we've instructed providers, don't give out that second dose to somebody else. Make sure there's a second dose for that person. If for some reason they miss the second dose, then they would really only have a partial immunity. Immunity builds over time with the first dose. And then when they get the second dose, it builds even further towards that, that 95%. The other thing that we've seen happen on a few occasions is somebody gets the COVID vaccine and then like a week later gets COVID. It's because their immunity wasn't built up enough to, you know, for them to have antibodies to fight off the virus. So you can't just get the shot and go, oh, I'm Superman. I'm just going to bust out and wear my mask and go party and do everything. No, we still need to practice those same 3 W's.
Awesome. So going along the lines in regards to one's immune system, if someone is immunocompromised due to a transplant, when should they expect to be called for vaccination?
You know, that's a question that is going to be best answered by their healthcare provider, because there's a lot of different scenarios in which they can be immunocompromised. And so the healthcare provider would know and would have the ability to access the literature that speaks specifically about, you know, that particular condition. And they also may be advised to wait for another type of vaccine to come out.
One thing I was thinking about as we were just chatting is, has there been any guidance or any, for lack of better words, templates provided to healthcare providers so that they could push that information out to their patients?
That's part of that whole training and onboarding process that we've had for all of our providers to get into that COVID vaccine management system, that CVMS system. Not only how to store and administer the vaccine, but all the background information as well.
All right, let me just chime in real quick. I want to remind people that we do need them to also to take the post-test. Only 3 people have submitted it, so please go ahead and start taking the post-test as well. And it is in the chat. I will put it in here one more time. Oh, you can go ahead, Kirsten. If there's one more, if there's not, you can go ahead and go to your other presentation you wanted to show real quick.
Thank you. The other question is kind of a deviant of what we already answered a little bit in regards to why is it that the Moderna vaccine does not need a lower temperature like the Pfizer vaccine?
I don't know the technical aspects of it, but you know how it was produced. And I think when we look at the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, the vaccine that's coming out from AstraZeneca, you know, they're going to have different parameters in terms of their storage and shelf life as well. And I believe the Johnson & Johnson also is likely to be a one-dose vaccine. So as more products come on the market, you know, we're hoping for greater shelf life, greater stability, greater ability to perhaps, you know, move the product around.
Thank you. And for the next few slides I have, I believe it's about 2 or 3 slides max. Deputy Money, if you could chime in as well with your background and expertise in regards to ways that we can chat and discuss, you know, the COVID-19 vaccination process in regards to medical mistrust.
Okay.
I'll put the slides I developed. This is brief talking points on the screen. But one of the things I thought about as I was sitting back thinking about how to start out this portion of the discussion in regards to medical mistrust. Are you guys able to see my slides?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you. We need to do it as a slideshow. Thank you. In terms of what are we going to do? How are we going to have this conversation? What exactly is medical mistrust? And as I sat back and thought about it and reached out to loved ones that are not necessarily in the field and having those conversations, one thing came evident to me. It was not necessarily medical mistrust, but mistrust of overarching systems. And so just wanted to share just a few historical contexts in regards to why is there medical mistrust? Why do we have mistrust of systems, and what does that mean? And so some of the things, thinking about it historically, the father of gynecology, he was the, his name was James Marion Simmons. Mm-hmm. And he was a physician, and he perfected some of his techniques for different surgeries on slave women. And the way in which he did it without any pain medication, you know, even though that was something that happened in the 1800s and it's benefiting women now, it's like we're receiving that benefit on the pain of women mm-hmm. back in the 1800s. Another piece we talk about, you hear a lot about, is the Tuskegee Syphilis Study. How many here on the call have heard of the Tuskegee Syphilis Study? And it was not that long ago that this event happened, in which the government, they had the cure for syphilis, but they wanted to see the natural progression of what happens with the disease. And so there were thousands of men that received what they thought was a treatment, but really was not a treatment. And not just it, not only did it impact them, but it also impacted their wives, their children, their loved ones. And there was already a cure for syphilis. Deputy Money, would you like to share a little bit more about the Tuskegee study?
No, you're absolutely right. And you also have eugenics, the North Carolina Eugenics Board. And, you know, just really within the last decade, has there been compensation for the survivors of eugenics in North Carolina? You know, with the syphilis study, that was actually something that was done by U.S. Public Health Service, right? It was done on people that had syphilis. There was no treatment that was provided to them. And the results of that study and that research, you know, was used in a way that people that participated had no agency over that information. And again, you know, a situation in which Black physicians, physicians of color, healthcare professionals of color weren't involved and weren't at the table. I think one of the things that has happened as a result of these atrocities is that as Black public health and medical professionals, we're more tuned in and we feel the obligation to do our due diligence to assure that any service, any treatment modality that is delivered to or provided for or encouraged for individuals to take within the Black community is really well vetted by us.
Exactly. You know, and what it does in the community, when community members hear about the programs, they hear about those that were involved in it, and then fast forwarding a couple years where there's someone else that's Black and brown trying to share information in regards to public health initiatives, and people therefore go back and they remember what happened to them and how people of color were used mm-hmm. in the unjust situation.
I think what you're seeing now too with the COVID vaccine is, you know, Black physicians really leading the way and rolling up their sleeves to get vaccinated, you know, to show and to demonstrate their knowledge and confidence of the vaccine, and also to be a living example of their trust in the vaccine that it's safe. We certainly know what COVID has done to our communities. We certainly know the damage and devastation, you know, that it's wrought. And so having the opportunity to have a means of protecting ourselves from COVID is something that we don't want to lose the opportunity, right? We don't want to get crowded out because we're hesitant in making a decision. We want to make a decision before our spot in the line comes up so that we can get our place to be able to get that vaccine.
Exactly. Just a few other examples, and I'll shift a little bit from the medical aspect, but to mm-hmm. other types of systems. One thing that came up a lot is the Reagan politics, not to talk political. And you hear the talk in the discussion in regards to how individuals that use crack were criminalized in the system. And that's an example of systematic racism and how not only did they have such harsh prison sentences versus the cocaine user and what they looked like, but then fast forward a few years and now it's a more prettier term. It's the opioid epidemic and it's the medical, the public health concern and some of that animosity that's still there in the community regarding how the crack epidemic was handled versus how the opioid epidemic is managed.
I'm going to chime in here real quick, Kirsten, because I do see a few people dropping off. We need about 12 more surveys, so please don't leave without taking the post test. We do want to make sure that our team immunity gets what they need from this call tonight and from your time. So I do appreciate if you would just hang on just a few more minutes. So Kirsten, in about 5 minutes, we'll go ahead and wrap up. And then if people want to stick around for a few more questions and anything else, we can do that.
Thank you. And so in the essence of time, I'll skip over some of the other examples that I have on the screen, but they're all examples in which traditionally medically underserved communities have been disenfranchised and marginalized. Mm-hmm. And the sheer trauma associated with poverty or from coming from a community that has a historical relevance in regards to poverty, how it is currently impacting our current health. And thinking about weathering and resiliency, and why is it that people of color or traditionally medically underserved communities are at a disadvantage when it comes to COVID-19 and they're battling the disease.
I would also include environmental justice on there as well, because so many communities of color are also in places where, you know, there's toxic waste dumps, there's excessive air pollution, there's fouled water. I mean, just think of like the Flint water crisis. You know, that's a known issue. There are many other communities where, you know, that's not known.
Right.
And those children in Flint, Michigan, you know, are going to have developmental delays, and they will not achieve their full potential educationally because of the impact that lead has on the developing brain. And that, and those families, those children will never be compensated for that. It's a completely unjust system that we're seeing, you know, not just historically, but play out right now, right before our eyes. These are children that are in school right now that are performing poorly because, you know, the government in Flint, Michigan allowed, you know, that water to be diverted from the Detroit River, and what it did to the linings and the lead released in the pipes in their drinking water. They're still drinking bottled water to this day as a result of that.
Wow. That is, yeah, that's sad. Mm-hmm. Very sad. So I am going to pause here because I do see where people are starting to maybe drop off. I want to make sure that they get everything in. Just let me grab for a moment here, Kirsten, and then I'll slide it back. I want to recognize Deputy Money for his time and coming out again. And let me share my screen real quick.
I hope you'll invite me back for an update.
Oh, yes, most definitely.
All right.
I mean,
I look forward to it.
Yeah, unfortunately, it sounds like we're going to be getting to know each other well in a way that I wish it wasn't so. But unfortunately, that is how it is going to happen. But I do want to just give you our appreciation for your time. Thank you. If we were in person, we would want to give this to you in person, but unfortunately, we're not able to do that. But we always want to make sure we present our speakers, our panelists, for providing for us their time and being able to give us an update and enhance our knowledge. So we do appreciate that. And I just wanted to make sure I got this in front of you while we still had a good audience of people here to give you a shout out in the chat, to give you a thumbs up, or to, in their own way, show their appreciation. So would everyone please provide a hand clap, a shout out, or a thumbs up or hand wave if you want to use the reaction buttons in the Zoom. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And I hope that you all will take up my invitation to share this presentation and be one of our community presenters. We'll give you updated information about COVID, updated slide decks, and you'll get sort of firsthand insights as to how our work around the vaccination effort is progressing. So please email me if you're interested.
Awesome. We'll also send that out. And a couple of quick things. I know we had some new members. Just want to welcome them. New members, if you are on the call tonight, please email our membership chair. His name is Elliot Locke, and you can reach him at membership@nsbertp.org. And he can connect with you on getting you oriented into NSBE and finding your way around the organization. Also, we do have, we're planning to move forth with elections. So there is a meeting coming up on February the, I want to say it is the 2nd. I got something in front of the screen there. I can't see it.
It's the 2nd, Tony.
2nd. All right. So this is on our Eventbrite page. It's also on our website, nsbertp.org, to come out if you're interested in running for office. This will be where you can get information. If you are interested in the admin zone, you need to go ahead and submit your form. I think that deadline is the 25th. So it was in our last newsletter. So please let us know if you're interested in the admin zone. That will be president, vice president, secretary, programs chair, or treasurer. Also, just real quick, I want to mention that we were a part of the National Mentoring Month recognition that took place here in the Research Triangle area. We were partnering with several other organizations. Basically, National Mentoring Month is the month of January. NSBE has a lot of individuals who have been mentoring and coaching with our team. So I want to recognize Brian and Ambria Tweedy. They're shown here. Cortex has added about 15 people to help us out. So thank you all for mentoring and coaching our K through 12 students in these teams. A couple of other quick things. We are already taking the assessment, so thank you for that. This is the list of all of the teams. So they will be presenting at the virtual conference, the National Virtual Conference, April 5th through the 9th. More to come on that. If your company is interested in supporting that with a donation or some other way, please reach out to me and we will talk further offline. Also, some of us have been following these conjunctions in the sky since December, and there's going to be astronomy days coming up. I'll send this out to the NSBE Junior distribution list. If you are not a member of NSBE Junior, you want your child, or you know someone who has a child that may be interested, please send that to presjunior@nsbertp.org. And we're interested in starting an interest group called the Astronomical Adventurers. We do have a general body meeting on January 29th for NSBE Junior. It's going to be exploring Earth, Aero, and outer space. Our own John Winstead, the telecom chair, is going to be the guest speaker for that. And we will also be talking about opportunities for students to explore this more. There's already an increase in demand in this field, so we need to start building that pipeline as well. And also, if you know college students who are at colleges that don't have a NSBE chapter, they can still participate through Research Triangle Collegiates, and this is on our website as well. We did have two students that got the John Deere Scholarship, Craig Fitzpatrick and Brendan Jenkins. They should be receiving those checks soon. So congratulations to them. They got $1,000 each. I'm sure they're going to put that to great practice. And I'm glad that we could help them out. We will be distributing shirts. We do have some that have been purchased, some that we are presenting in Deputy Money. We also want to make sure you get a shirt, so please send me your size. We're sending these out as commemorative shirts from our 2019-2020 chapter of the year recognition. So if you're still interested in that, there's a few left. And we do have ethics and AI. Please go ahead and register for that. That's January 25th. This is also on the website or our Eventbrite page. We're going to continue the keeping an eye on equity focus. We got to make sure that the artificial intelligence doesn't have bias. So that's what that's going to be about. And Ayanna Littlejohn, who is our triathlon coach, she's going to be speaking at this webinar for her company SAS on the 28th. So we want to come out and support her. And that is it. I know that was pretty quick, so I wanted to get all of those in. But at this point, if you want to continue to stay on and complete the survey, please do so. I'm going to pass it back over to Kirsten and Deputy Money, and we'll stick around for maybe another 15 minutes and take a few more questions. All right, there you go, Kirsten.
Awesome. Thank you, Tony. And I promise it to you really quickly, really quick. One thing I wanted to share really quickly in regards to the presentation is, you know, where do we go from here and our needed next steps? And the different levels that we have to make changes are on the macro level, which is on an individual level in regards to the micro level in the community members. And some of the examples I think about with that include the work that has been done and completed when we went to the apartment complex in Raleigh. And we had hands-on trainings in regards to how community members could use their devices. And then on a macro level, you sit back and think about how the data is collected in ways that we're able to take that information and move it forward. And so I just put up on the screen just a few key recommendations from the Medical Association. And that includes understanding the health equities that were present before COVID-19 hit, the importance of having health literacy resources in multiple languages, as well as the data collection methodology and how we can gather that information in a systematic way so that we can report out accurately where we are in regards to the COVID cases, the COVID vaccination processes, etc., and then ways to assess and work with the digital health literacy and access divide. And so one thing, if I put on for a moment my work hat, as many of you know, I work at the Duke Cancer Institute in the Office of Health Equity, and we have a community health ambassador program. And it's something we kind of chatted about informally offline, and we wanted to bring this opportunity as well to the members of NSBE to see if you would be interested in learning more about the Community Health Ambassador Program. And so the purpose of the program is to build capacity within the communities to help facilitate knowledge regarding cancer prevention and screening, as well as clinical trials, as well as at the end of the day, the overarching goal is to decrease health disparities in cancer. One of the things that we found in a couple of different assessments that we've completed throughout the community is, wow, members may have access to a device, about 50%. That 50%, they do not know how to use that device to access telehealth medicine and how to utilize their device to the best of its ability so that they're able to have those communications with their providers. And so maybe we can get a subset of NSBE members together that are interested in becoming a community health ambassador to learn more about cancer prevention as well as overarching chronic disease prevention as well, and clinical trials and clinical trial participation, and then have it where we can do some train the trainer models, where we can train others that are in the community on ways that they could go out and train their fellow colleagues, residents, etc., as far as how they can use their device so they can get good validated information using the technology that they have, or if there's a need for it, that we're able to help share some linkages of ways we can get those devices into some people's hands. And there's a lot of different organizations out there that have programs that can either help, depending on, you know, what your circumstances, can help provide devices to you, or they could help provide a device at a substantially decreased and subsidized rate, some that are refurbished ones. So maybe those are some things that we can think about. Our next training that we have in the office is going to be on February 19th from 1 o'clock to 5 o'clock, or February 20th from 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. And so if you're interested in learning about that, please let us know. We'd love to have you come have that conversation with you beforehand and discuss some tangible next steps. But at the end of the day, when it comes down to some of our action items and what we can do, while we on the call may know how to access the information or may know how to utilize the information, do our loved ones know how to utilize that access and tap into that information or use their devices? And so the challenge is to really reach back into your own households, into your own communities, into your own families, so that you can show and teach them how that they can access this information so that they can know about it. One thing I think about is with the vaccinations, one thing, I sat back and I smiled because they said, oh, vaccinations are open to those that are 75 years of age and older. We let people know through my chart. How many people in your family or your household are aware of my chart, know how to access my chart, or that they're proactively going out and looking on my chart to even receive such a message? And so those are ways that the digital divide is exacerbating right. our ability to get things such as the vaccination.
That's exactly right, Kirsten. And how old does someone have to be to participate in this training?
The person or the participants, we would like for them to be over the age of 18. In special circumstances, if someone is under the age of 18, maybe they can have that conversation with their parents. For them to receive the training, but the target age range for the training is someone that's 18 years of age or older. And you know, we've had people go through the training that are seniors. You know? So it's definitely an open to that wide range.
Okay. Excellent. I do like the fact that you're addressing the digital divide. That's actually right up our alley. We can talk further offline about that because I definitely have seen that. I try to be that person in my family with my seniors. If you have a relative that goes in the hospital and they're not on my charts or they don't, you know, they're not keeping up with the medicines and the doctor's notes, then you're just going to get lost. So you need a family representative, an advocate that does know how to get in there and is keeping track of that. If you have grandparents or older parents, you definitely... If they're not using it, well, first of all, if you don't know if they're using it, you need to find out. And if they're not, then you need to get them on it because they're missing out if they're not on it. And things have definitely changed. There's some information that is kind of expected now for us to be able to do on our own. So it's a new level of literacy. It's just like learning to read. There was a time when a lot of people in our community did not have access to education, so they did not know how to read. So someone had to read for them. Or they did not comprehend, so someone had to be the person in the family that would read over documents and comprehend and explain. So we need to do the same thing now in a digital fashion to close that divide. So thank you, Kirsten, for bringing this to our attention. If someone is interested in reaching Kirsten, can you put your email in the chat? I know that there may be some other questions about the programs that you've mentioned and even... other things that you've shared. Can you put a if you want to use the NSBE email, you can use that one as well, the public health one. Okay, and put that in the chat. All right. Was there anything else? I'm getting ready to close out. I know this is such a great topic, and I could actually stay on a couple more hours, but I have to go to work tomorrow, and I know others do too. But this is a very good topic, and it's so much information. It's so much to learn. And I have some people who already have asked me, they couldn't make it. They want to get a copy of it. They still even want to take the survey. So that's a good thing. I do appreciate you, Deputy Money, for coming out. And yes, we do want you to come back and do an update. We want to follow this thing and do all that we can to try to help our community. All righty. Well, if there's not any further ado, I'm going to go ahead and close out tonight. Thank you all for coming. I am going to stick on a little bit. I know there's some people who are asking me some questions here in the chat. I'm going to finish those up. If you still want to get the survey in, I will stick around so we can get that done. We will make the information that was shared, that I shared tonight, available. I don't know, Deputy Money, is your information accessible to the public, what you shared? Is any of that? I think you'll
yes, and in fact, I'll send you that deck.
Awesome.
Yep.
Okay, thank you. And Kirsten, how about yours? Is that available as well?
I emailed you as well.
I just want to make sure it's okay to share with the public before we send it out. Awesome. So I will send it out to everyone who is registered for the event tonight, and hopefully that will hit everybody. And if you didn't get registered, we'll figure out a way to get it to our website or some other format. Everyone have a nice evening. Thank you for joining. Until next time, be safe. And remember the three W's, right?
That's right.
Right.
And try to attend at least part of the inauguration tomorrow. We're getting tomorrow.
All right. This is okay. I'm not endorsing anybody. I can't do that. NSBE can't endorse. But I can say we do have a new administration.
That's right.
We do need to take advantage of the opportunity. It is historic. I can say that. And I don't know the time, but if someone does know the time.
Noon.
Okay. I think the activities will start at like 9, earlier than that. But yeah, the actual inauguration
is at noon.
Also, too, I did not get a chance to have a prior presenter come back. She wanted me to just let you know, please be vigilant if you're going to be out, especially near Capitol tomorrow. Be vigilant. They are expecting some protests. I believe there may be some here locally that people are anticipating. White supremacists and those against white supremacists. So that is going to be what the environment may be like. So if you have to go out and you're going to be near the Capitol, please take care of yourself. Please keep that in mind. Everybody have a great one. Have a blessed one. Take care.
You too. Bye-bye.
Mm-hmm. Bye-bye.
Bye, everyone.
Bye-bye.